So I see a lot of comments, and the common thread is, oh, this is perfect, but it just doesn't have enough I/O on the board, or it doesn't have enough networking, or, you know, this is a great board, but it's just, you know, not got what I need, and I want a different board, or whatever, when you're doing your home lab. I gotta get you to think in terms of PCIe lanes, and where those PCIe lanes come from, and how to make that all work, instead of thinking about what your motherboard has on board, which is nice, but not necessarily relevant, especially when you're coloring outside the line. More and more, PCIe is just a generic interconnect. It could be a PCIe slot, it could be an M.2, it could be a U.2, it could be an Oculink connector, it could be a, you know, an SFF Slim SAS connector. A lot of the time, your phone, your tablet, whatever, is just a physical chip that's just soldered in, but it's PCI Express. PCI Express lanes everywhere, 24 lanes to the CPU. It's 4 for the NVMe, 16 for the GPU, and 4 for the chipset in the case of Ryzen. The chipset uses 4 PCIe 4.0 lanes for itself, but it provides more PCIe lanes. This can be fine as long as the total bandwidth from everything coming from the chipset can't really exceed that whole 8 gigabytes per second that 4 PCI Express 4.0 lanes provide. That's how much bandwidth you've got with that kind of a connector. So yeah, I mean, you could run a PCI Express 3.0 by 8 device on a 4.0 by 4 link through the chipset, and that would be fine. There's no bottleneck there if you think about it in those terms. Now, the chipset also provides SATA, USB, networking a lot of the time. And again, those things are much slower, so generally not a bottleneck. Alder Lake, 12th generation from Intel, 28 lanes, 8 4.0 lanes to the chipset, not 4 like AMD, 4 dedicated to an NVMe and 16 to a PCIe card. Although Ryzen 7000 might change that. Ryzen have a trick up their sleeve that, as far as I can tell, Alder Lake doesn't, and that is that X16 slot can run at by 4x4x4x4 or by 8x4x4, and actually by 8x4x4 is a popular configuration for home servers. So you can break that X16 slot out into other things, assuming that you can find the right hardware. So Z690 and B660 motherboards, as I was kind of alluding to, they can't do X4, 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 as far as I can tell. However, I've been told the W680, that's a chipset for LGA 1700 for, you know, low-end workstation boards, can do them. They launched in January, but I can't buy it. And it should support X8, X4, X4 for Alder Lake. So our plucky little i3 here could run it not just by 8x8, but also by 8x4x4. But I can't get my hands on that motherboard. So, by way of an example, suppose I wanted to build a network security appliance to generate really big logs. Now remember our Supermicro pizza box server? That is maybe the perfect server for that. You can get it with up to 8 onboard NICs, plus you still got the PCIe slot. And that PCIe slot means that we can add a 10 gigabit NIC, dual 10 gig here. And then, what if we also need a 2.5 gigabit DMZ and we've only got 8 onboard 1 gig ports? Well, we can cheat. I've got this M.2, which breaks out into a 2.5 gig NIC. And this isn't Realtek. This is actually an Intel 225V. And you get these with single and dual NIC, and yeah, I might have to get a little creative with the chassis, but here it is, it can do it. Remember our ASRock desk meet? It's only got the one NIC. What if I want two NICs? I can add this to it. It's got two M.2, one in the back, one in the front. This will work great on the one in the front, just above the GPU. It's got plenty of clearance. It'll work fine, and then I've got a dual setup with my X16 slot being free. But Wendell, you say, 2.5 gig is too slow. I want 10 gig, all right? Our 10 gig card, we can actually break out and connect this PCIe card edge connector actually to M.2. We just need an adapter cable for that. M.2 to PCI Express by 4, okay, it's not super convenient shoving this thing in an M.2 port, but you can use a riser cable, and the riser cable lets you relocate things. That works for X16 slots too. We'll talk about that more later. Cheat codes, am I right? Now we can rock dual 10 gig on an ITX motherboard or something like this without even using one of our PCIe slots. And yeah, you have to get a little creative with the mounting and the placement, but you've got a 3D printer and you can, you know, take the back plate off here and use some creatively placed standoffs to keep it from shorting out. The Minis Forum Ryzen 8 cores, it's perfect. It's a perfect routing appliance for your house, but it's only got the single 2.5 gig LAN. Again, you can get creative with this, and now you've got a dual 2.5 gig LAN that's using like 15 watts at idle. It's sort of nuts. Now what if you've got some fire-breathing enterprise-class U.2 drives, U.2 being that thick 2.5-inch form factor? Well, guess what? That's just another form of PCI Express. Intel themselves make these M.2 to U.2 breakout cables. This is just good old standard SATA power, and this is our U.2 connection, and then this goes in an M.2 slot, and this is low profile. Maybe you've got a camera that uses CF Express, Compact Flash Express cards. Well, guess what? That's PCIe in a little tiny card form factor. Boom, cheat code, this thing. This will break out an M.2 into, you know, a cable, and this will fit a standard size, standard length M.2. And this is literally just a physical adapter. That's all it is. There's no electronics in here. Why? Because everything is PCI Express. I've also got the Kioxia BG5. These are kind of coming in vogue. You can use these, but this is a lot more than you need if you're gonna rock this. They actually make smaller adapters now where this M.2 will fit entirely inside a CF Express card. The only thing that you would really get tripped up on with a camera if you're doing this kind of a cheat code is devices that use CF Express have a lower power ceiling than desktop computer counterparts. So while Samsung makes SSDs like the PM991, which is a very similar form factor to our Kioxia, the Kioxia BG4 and the BG5 that I have here in my hand, this is 1 terabyte, and you can get this plus an adapter for on the order of $150. CF Express cards for a terabyte are much more than $150. I mean, these Kioxia drives are so Lilliputian and so power frugal that you can even use these to upgrade the Steam Deck, and you would need an adapter bracket. Get the 256 gig Steam Deck, upgrade with Kioxia, you can do it and have extra room. Of course, by the same token, you really can't get away with shoving a GPU into that M.2 PCIe adapter either. The adapter is only rated for 25 watts, not 75 watts that a GPU is gonna demand from that PCIe slot. Also, with the mining bust that's happening now, there are a lot of similar adapters on the market that I will caution you against. Those suck. Generally, they're only PCI Express by one, and one lane, I mean, and they are usually PCI Express 1.0 or PCI Express 2.0. It's kind of like the True Value Game Genie. It kind of sort of would work, but it kind of sort of will glitch out later. Now, in some servers, there's also Oculink cables or SFF cables that I've showed in other motherboard videos to route PCI Express from one place to another. Above Normie Pleb on our forum actually has a lot more exotic options that they've posted on the forum, and an M.2 breakout card that has a programmable PCIe redriver on them. What? Redriving PCIe signals for integrity? Yeah, beat me to the punch on that one. So you can see all those posts on the forum and see what a headache it is, and probably not something you want to get into, but you do have the option. Now, if you don't have enough lanes, meaning that, you know, 16 or 24 or 28 lanes is not enough for you, you can get other devices to help you mux them together. Highpoint, for example, is making a M.2 RAID card now, and that has more M.2 connections than it has lanes, but then you can do stuff with that. Well, okay, you can't really do stuff with that. It's just for storage, but there are other devices you can import from China. I'll just mention that as well if you want to get really creative. Now, I've seen people buy or not buy a motherboard specifically because of USB edge cases. Here's your USB cheat code. This is an internal USB hub. This one's from MSI. This is sort of nuts, but if you need more USB at the rear of your case, you can combine this with these breakout cables. And so this will connect to your USB 2 header, and then you've got more USB 2 ports. And yes, there are USB 3 versions of this as well. So you can take your onboard, you know, that extra 30-pin front panel header that your case probably doesn't have, four USB 5 gigabit ports at the front, take the other one to the back, or route it to a hub and then have even more USB 3 connectivity at the back. You know, it's, as USB chipsets go, motherboards will usually use a good to decent chipset, and add in PCIe cards. Like, if you get a PCIe card that has USB on it, those chipsets are usually the reject ones, so it's really not great. And if you use the hub, then this is just a hub, but it's just internal to your computer, so you don't have to manage it outside the computer. So electrically, they're different things. If you really needed the PCIe bandwidth or the USB bandwidth to PCIe, then it might be worth finding a good name brand card. But in general, I'd probably recommend Thunderbolt for that use case instead, because Thunderbolt chipsets are usually better, and they can also do USB. Thunderbolt's cool too, because you can sometimes use an external enclosure to get even more mileage out of your Thunderbolt connection. It's like, oh, you don't have to run a GPU in there? Other things can work? Yeah, you could run a 10 gig network card. I did that for a while on a system that only had Thunderbolt connections. So what about cheating in other ways other than connectivity? If you're not thinking in terms of just PCIe lanes yet, let's talk other M.2 stuff. What about M.2 VGA breakouts? Yeah, there are M.2 VGA cards. Why does that exist? Well, this is another seriously underrated peripheral that should expand the possibilities for you and your imagination as you go through it. This works really well if you're building a system with a Ryzen CPU that doesn't have a built-in GPU and you want it in a small, compact system. Some motherboards won't post if there's a GPU that's missing or there's no GPU in the system. So you can use an M.2, and you can use an M.2 hanging off the chipset, so you don't really lose anything in terms of bandwidth, and add a peripheral like your Mellanox Connect X5 and a PCI Express X16 slot. And I've got good news about that. If you're home labbing and you're doing experiments with 100 gigabit, because that's what you use at work and you want to do stuff, there's not really a less expensive way to do that than a 16 core 5950X or a 12 core 5900X. It's loads of fun. You get all 16 lanes to the network, and you've got a CPU that can actually keep up with that. And yeah, you can also do DIY cooling. I've got a 3-pin blower fan. These are super, super cheap. You can control the RPM to keep them quiet, but don't underestimate a blower fan. Why would you need a blower fan? Well, a lot of enterprise stuff is designed for high airflow. So this blower fan combines with this 3D printed shroud adapter, and then boom, I've got cooling for a Tesla V100. This is also not super loud. It can keep that 240 watt V100 running at full turbo all the time and just barely is audible. Maybe you've got a PCIe slot and you need an M.2 slot. There's an adapter for that. You can go the other way. It's not really a problem. The most disappointing thing about getting this stuff together for this video is I've kind of had it waiting in the wings for a while, and I haven't been able to get my hands on a W680 motherboard. It's a W680 chipset. That's for LGA 1700. These Alder Lake P-Cores and embedded systems for home labbing is gonna be just as transformational as the $300 Ryzen 7 1700 was when it launched. Weird things happen if you mix P-Cores and E-Cores. You don't have to look very far to verify that. Like the VMware ESXi in your home lab, it's like, why are we... There are some fixes in now in VMware 7 Update 3, I think, but it's still kind of a dumpster fire with regard to hyper-threading or not hyper-threading. Of course, Linux is fine. You know, if you wanted to rock the i5 or the i7 for your home lab and mix P and E cores, okay, fine. But 6 P cores for ESXi, no E cores at all. It's a completely fine setup. And you can mix and match some of these other technologies. Add 10 gig, add your M.2 breakout, and still have a really small form factor. Micro ATX. And something like this is also a really good approach. You know, this is the X470 version, which has been considerably cheaper than the X570 from ASRock Rack. And at about $200, this is a steal for a home server because it's very power frugal. You can put in it, you know, a 12 or a 16 core CPU. You could put in a 6 or an 8 core CPU, that's fine. It has remote management, IPMI, really good monitoring. And it's micro ATX, so you've got a pretty good layout. So for your home labbing, you can get really creative. You don't have to have the expensive $200 motherboard. A Ryzen 1700, as long as it doesn't have the segfault bug, plus, you know, a sub $100 AM4 motherboard might actually be net cheaper than building a system like this, and it's still just the same incredible home labbing platform. And the reason that I'm so excited for newer-ish hardware for your home lab is because even that Ryzen 7 1700 is gonna run circles around more ancient cast-off server stuff. Memory capacity and things like that is a little more problematic because, you know, getting 128 gigs of DDR3 from that genre, not super expensive, not really a big deal. 128 gigs for something like this is basically still the platform limit. But then you can look for, you know, used Naples servers. There were a lot of servers for first-gen Epic that were not upgradable to Rome. Those are just starting to hit eBay, and you can find a super, super deal. May have some videos on that coming soon. I did the video on the Xeon 8124Ms. Those are Amazon cast-offs. Depending on the alignment of the planets and whether or not Mercury's in retrograde, you may be able to find some really good deals from Amazon or other enterprises that have been cast off into the e-waste era or cast off into, you know, somewhere that you could find and incorporate that into your home server. I'm still rocking those dual 8124Ms. They're on a mission and they work great. Work fabulously well in that Gigabyte chassis. It's eight dual 18 cores. I got no complaints there, especially for what I paid. Also forgot to mention something you can look for that's an easy mode cheat code, something like this. This is the Synology E10 M20T1. This is for Synology NAS, but it's just a PCIe card. It'll work at anything. You put this in your device and you've got 10 gig Ethernet plus M.2. M.2 all on one card? Really? Two M.2, actually. There's some trade-offs there, but PCI Express by 8 and you get both connections plus 10 gig Ethernet. It's a pretty good fix. This is an Intel DC 4511 ruler format. This is the short, not super tall ruler format that doesn't have a built-in heatsink. This is not an engineering sample. This is a production sample. It was from a server pool. You know, it had been wiped and all that kind of stuff. Manufacture date was about 2 years ago. And it's 4 terabytes, but it was like $200 on the recycling scene. And then this is an adapter card to take it into U.2. It's cheating. I don't have a chassis that uses a ruler format in my home lab, do you? I mean, most people probably don't. And yet, it'll work fine. It doesn't physically work fine. I can't use this in a normal U.2 enclosure, in fact. This is only 3D printing double stick tape country to the side of the case, but hey, it'll work. I'm Wendell, this is level one. This is some home lab server cheat codes. You may be able to pull it off with the hardware you have with just a little bit of PCI Express glue to get you from A to B, and you didn't even know. All right, I'm signing out, and you can find me in the Level 1 forums.